So I figured the easiest way to explain what we're going to be building is to show you this drawing, which displays all the different components of the architecture and the infrastructure that we're going to be working with. All right, so the first thing that we need to do is install the delivery controller. Now, how do we interact with the delivery controller once it's installed? Anyone? Well, if you said Studio, then you're absolutely correct. The Citrix Studio is the management console that you would use to interact with your delivery controller as an administrator. So once we've got that going, now we're able to communicate with this delivery controller. The delivery controller is then going to need a place to store the settings and the configuration that you're about to do. And for that matter, it's going to require a database. And as we go through the demonstration, you'll see that we are going to be using SQL Server Express to create that database. Once we've got these components, well, now we need access to the license server, the Citrix license server. And best practice calls that you have the Citrix license server on its own virtual machine or physical machine. We're going to put it on its own VM during this course. Now, the reason you need the license server is that it gives you access to the right features and technologies that you've paid for or that you're going to be using during your installations and implementations. Once we have these three core components, these are the coarse of core components, we can start to look at use cases. The first one, probably one of the more popular use cases, is going to be your VDI use case. Now, for VDI, what do you need? You need essentially three components, right? You need the VDA, which is typical. We're going to need the VDA for almost, well, for all the use cases. We're going to need also a hypervisor, and you obviously need your VMs. Now, once we have those three components, you can deliver those VMs in two different ways. You can deliver them via PVS, or you can deliver them via MCS. Now, who can tell me what MCS stands for? Correct. MCS stands for Machine Creation Services. So with provisioning services, what you're doing is you are streaming the operating system to that VM. The VM can be diskless. It does not need a local virtual hard disk in order for it to operate. With machine creation services, you actually have to have a local virtual disk for the VM because it will be storing certain data bits on that actual disk. So think of machine creation services as linked clones of an actual master image. So that's one of the first use cases. Now, if you're trying to do XenApp, for instance, well, that would be your use case number two, and we're going to call this use case Server OS. We obviously also need a VDA. So once you install the VDA on any of the supported operating systems, they are server operating systems, you're able to deliver your published applications or published desktops on a shared model approach. Now, another use case could be the same as SOS, or server operating system, but it is DOS, or desktop operating system. Now, what is desktop operating system? Well, desktop operating system is when you have one of those applications that doesn't work on a server operating system, but you still want to install it and manage it centrally. So you install it on a desktop operating system like Windows XP or Windows 7, Windows 8, and Windows who knows what. And then you publish the application from that desktop operating system. The difference here is that with a server operating system, you install that application and you can have 100 users connect to that server. No problem, right? Pretty simple. In the desktop operating system, if you install the application on a desktop, that desktop is not a multi-user per se operating system. So what ends up happening is if you have 100 users that need access to that application, you need to provision 100 VMs with that application installed on them in order for you to give access to this application. And then the last use case that I want to talk about here is called remote PC, and it obviously also needs a VDA. Now, this use case is when you have those physical machines at home or in the office that you need access to. You install a VDA agent on them, and you're able to remotely access that physical PC or laptop that's in your office. Now, in order for your help desk to be able to interact with this environment, in order for them to be able to troubleshoot it, they need access to a console. And in this case, the console that they have access to is called Citrix Director. So with the Citrix Director, they're able to troubleshoot this entire environment when phone calls start to come in. Now, for users to get access to these resources, if they're internal users, they're able to access them using the storefront. Now, storefront is simply like a web interface that they can visit, launch application icons, and they get access to these resources. It is also obviously connected to the delivery controller, because the delivery controller is going to inform the incoming user how to go, where to connect, which VM is going to be available, which server is available with the least load, etc. So that is connected through the delivery controller. Now that's for internal users. If users want to come in from outside the firewall securely, then you will need to deploy what's known as a NetScaler. Now NetScaler is not the only technology that you can use to have reverse proxy functionality. You can use maybe an F5 or something else, but typically NetScaler is recommended just because it'll integrate very seamlessly into the Citrix product lines, and it has some additional features and functionality that would enhance the user experience. But you would deploy a NetScaler, and then any user essentially from the outside that has a receiver on a device is able to connect and get access to all of your resources. Now, if users don't have access to a receiver and they still want to get access to these resources, as long as they connect to an HTML5 or with an HTML5 browser, then that should be also fine, and you'll be able to connect them to all of these resources.